अभिषेक, ऑल गुड। ओके, यू कैन हैव द फुल स्क्रीन मोड। अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू एवरीवन। इट इज अ ग्रेट प्रेजर दैट आई वेलकम मिस्टर राजन गोविंद, डायरेक्टर एट बीईएस, बीईएस कंसल्टेंट्स प्राइवेट लिमिटेड मुंबई। दिस टू दिस वेबिनार सीरीज, दिस इज फॉर एडवांस बिल्डिंग कंस्ट्रक्शन एंड मटेरियल, फोर्थ ईयर एट सुशांत स्कूल ऑफ आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चर, गुड़गांव। तो विद ग्रेट प्लेजर आई वेलकम मिस्टर गोविंद टू दिस सीरीज टू इनलाइटन द स्टूडेंट्स ऑन फसाद सिस्टम्स। अ ब्रीफ अबाउट मिस्टर गोविंद, राजन हैज मोर देन 27 ईयर्स ऑफ इंटरनेशनल एक्सपीरियंस विद इन द फसाद इंडस्ट्री, आउट ऑफ विच ही हैज सर्व मोर देन 11 ईयर्स विद अरूप कंसल्टेंसी। विद स्ट्रक्चरल इंजीनियरिंग बैकग्राउंड, राजन हैज गेन्ड वर्किंग एक्सपीरियंस इन वेरियस रीजनल सच एज एशिया, मिडिल ईस्ट, ऑस्ट्रेलिया। ही हैज एक्सटेंसिव एक्सपीरियंस इन बोथ वेल बिल्ट एंड एग्जिस्टिंग बिल्डिंग्स। ही हैज सक्सेसफुली डिलीवर्ड सेवरल प्रेस्टीजियस प्रोजेक्ट्स विद इंटीग्रेशन फसाद डिजाइन इन्वॉल्विंग 3D डिजाइन, कॉम्प्लेक्स इंजीनियरिंग एंड बिल्डिंग इंटीग्रेशन सिस्टम। ही इज अ सर्टिफाइड SGMM सिंगापुर ग्रीन मार्क मैनेजर, विच इनेबल्स हिम्स टू अंडरस्टैंड सस्टेनेबल डिजाइन रिक्वायरमेंट फ्रॉम आर्किटेक्चरल एंड प्रैक्टिकल पर्सपेक्टिव। ही हैज मैनेज्ड एंड डिलीवर्ड सेवरल लार्ज प्रोजेक्ट्स विद हाईली प्रैक्टिकल एंड एफिशियंट डिजाइन्स, रिजल्टिंग इन सक्सेसफुल इम्प्लीमेंटेशन सच एज मॉन्डियल हाइट्स, द पार्क, ब्रिज टेक गार्डन, पैन पैसिफिक होटल सिंगापुर, ASPTM हॉस्पिटल वियतनाम। ही इज पैशनेट इन फ्यूचर टेक्नोलॉजीज एंड एक्सपेरिमेंट्स विद इनोवेशन, हैज टेकन वेरियस एफर्ट्स टू अडॉप्ट टेक्नोलॉजी टू इम्प्रूव द एफिशियंसी इन डिजाइन एंड कंस्ट्रक्शन एस्पेक्ट्स। With his extensive international and regional experience in the facade and construction industry, he is a known face in the regional facade industry with good reputation of high quality work completed. Over to you, sir. Welcome on the webinar platform for Sushant. Sir, I think you are on mute.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm just starting it. Is it audible?
It's okay. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, first of all, thank you for the opportunity to present your students. Thank you to Sushant University Management, and special thanks to Mr. Ravi Ravichandran. He managed to contact me and then get organized this. First of all, thanks for everyone. I will try to show some interesting about practical approach of facade engineering and design from the energy efficiency point of view, and maybe some green building design aspects. You can interrupt me, or I can ask any questions after we finish it. We will try to cover some topics today. I have managed to put what I feel from design point of view may be critical, such as various forms and application of facades, design approaches, case studies and comparisons. We can show some of our information and data from our projects that we have been working on, and some advanced material and latest trends for what is going on throughout the international scenario. And some basic construction techniques, how these techniques are different from traditional building approaches. Various forms of facades. Facades, or we call building envelope, has no limitation or definition or boundaries. It essentially anything covered to skin of the building we work, being different types of building, commercial, high rises, residential, and large spaces, public infrastructures, and the design is basically covered by architectural and various function requirements of these building types. And even residential, we could have as simplest form of windows on a residential or on our apartments, or as complex as an expensive bespoke system, curtain wall glazing for same residential. So it is all derived from the architectural market requirements and requirements. And the forms, there is no definition to the forms. It can take any shape or any geometry, any sizes. And at the end, it serves some functions to the interior space, and it is protecting a harsh environment from external environment to the interior space. And an internal space has to be livable and comfortable. And from the designer, either architectural point of view or engineer's point of view on a facade, from energy efficient aspects, we can look at different aspects. But I try to put some key aspects which drives the design is we have to do some lot of analysis and a theoretical analysis, which should reflect as closest to practical. And we have to work on certain numbers. That is all about it. And if your numbers are right, we can assume that end result will have a better building. It consumes less energy, and it costs less to build these buildings. From the facade aspects, we all the time look for three different aspects, like daylight. Make sure we get a good natural daylights come to the interior space, so that we don't have to use excessive additional energy for artificial lighting. And this is critical, such as if you're dealing with the large floor plates like office spaces, IT buildings, there where we have a large floor plate where daylighting becoming like highly precious. And then we look for a thermal comfort. Thermal comfort, we aim to achieve good comfort with the minimum use of energy, and have a less impact on natural resources. That's the aim of thermal comfort. And ultimately, if you put everything together, we will have to look at overall energy efficiency of the facade systems, use a lot of passive design techniques, and we use less expensive material, less material, lightweight material, and do better construction so that the envelope become highly energy efficient. And I will touch base few of these points. Maybe I'm not able to cover everything in this presentation, but I'll see the best to cover some of the basics. If you're looking on a building envelope, say such as if you're looking for a commercial buildings, it's easy to compare. There is no limitation on the designs. We could do it. We can show this where you have how do we treat vision glazing, which is opaque areas. It's like those familiar with the EGBC guidelines, you may be dealing with the window wall ratios, how we can maintain the window wall ratios, or what kind of material we can use. And whatever we do, it has a big architectural and as well as a functional impact. And there is other treatment we can do, like we can add a lot of shadings. And as we live in a hot climate, shading is one of the best, highly energy efficient approach. Where if you shade the building, it's like just a holding umbrella on your summer. It just cut down heat directly. That will have a big impact on your energy savings. So the shading, we focus a lot of different shading aspect as we live in a hot climate. And the moment we talk about shading, it also have a great impact on architectural, and it gives a functional. So sometimes it's not everything is doable. It has a different impact. So as a designer, we should have some balanced approach. And there's no limitation how many detailed design options we can drive to the particular building. So there's a numerous ways we can be designed. So design approach has a big impact on our overall performance of the building. The shading, there is a primary factor to put the shade is it directly cut the heat. And as we know, the glass is have some limitation on giving a comfort, and we use a facade glazing to give a good natural lighting, and it also compromises on one aspect and enhances on other aspects. So there are different reason or design options we can mitigate, such as shading. It could be horizontal shades or shades done in various different shapes. It's all no limitation. It just comes with the how creativity it could be. And there are shades we can do extensive amount of shades to shade the glazing or direct heat coming through to like a curtain. And we can make this operable as open and closed, or it can have a just a fixed sunshades. And you can also have the like vertical fins or horizontal sunshades. There is no limitations. And sometimes it could be either fixed or it can also dynamically changing. So there are several buildings done where the sunshades are dynamically changing according to the position. Though it's going to be an expensive, but it at the end gives a highly performance building with no compromise on any other aspects. And then it leads to different creativity of our architects. We can create a patterns from this shade, so it is not just a shade. Sometimes the sun shade doesn't fit with the particular architectural design. Maybe the architect would see the sunshade is breaking his design or creating difficult design for the building elevation. So then there are internationally well-known architects been trying to do with the different patterns coming out of the sunshades. Again, extensively shaded facades. You can see the facades almost, I could see approximately 50% of the facade is getting shaded, but there's no compromise. It is not blocking the view from inside. And the shade as done is completely in a different way here. And when we say shading the facade, not necessary, you need to have a physical sunshade. There are shading also achieved without a sunshade, so which is primarily driven from various treatment where we can do with the glazing material and use high performance glazing. And here we can see a lot of fritting has been done to reduce the heat coming through the facade. So there is no physical sunshade to cut the heat, but rather there are some fritting patterns done on a glazing where it gives. As you can see, the building on the right side though is just a glass box building, but this particular building has a platinum rated. So there are some misconception, right? If you have a glass facade, you cannot get the performances. Actually, there is no limitation. You can use various different materials, and it's all up to the how these materials put together and what kind of a detail. There are always lots of buildings done with lots of glazing, and there's no compromise. This building has achieved a higher level of rating. And you can see here the buildings basically fading out or done through some kind of a frit pattern is done in the glazing, which directly cut the heat coming through the facades. So that if you have this kind of a frit pattern, which will reduce the heat coming through, and this can be used on columns, beams, where there's no visual requirement. So it's not a vision glazing. These are done opaque areas, as we call like a spandrel areas. And there is no just a limit to the glass. There are various materials we can consider for facades, such as metal cladding, natural materials. And this all helps to go with advanced construction techniques where if you're looking for a high-rise building, there we'll try to look for a lightweight and flexible material so that the building overall impact will be much lesser. So there are different ways we can look on a building envelope, not just a glass box building. You could have a windows, you could have a strip windows, and a combination of various different materials. And there are different approaches I showed you before. I will go through these three different design approach, out of which most important, as we will see on most of the facade, is a daylight. Daylight, we have to maximize the daylight is coming through, as we have abundant amount of sunshine here in our country. we try to utilize this daylight and try to bring as deep as to the flow space without causing a glare or discomfort. So this is a plan view showing we have just checked for one of our project as critical time. You can see one side of the facade is not getting proper lighting, and whatever the red color, you can see a good amount of lighting. So this will drive something needed to bring the daylight on other end of the facades. And same, we can apply this to any buildings, any types of building, residential, commercial, or kind of building. And this will also help to understand how do we shade the building and what is the dimension of the shades to be and where to put the shade so that the shade really works very effectively. And we have to understand the sunshade like this. This particular slide, you can see how much deeper the light is penetrating to the building. As especially the large floor plate building, we have a difficulty to bring the sun lighting deeper inside. There are ways we can do. If we have such challenges, maybe we have to carefully select the glazing material or glass properties so that it brings a lot of daylight without causing a discomfort or other issues such as a glaring. So we have to work on numbers. We can see what is the lux levels coming in and how much deep is penetrating into the floor space. And we do also work on a plan view, make sure at least 3 meters on a floor plate you have you're getting minimum level of lighting, so it doesn't affect too much getting darker and not relying on too much artificial lighting. And on a typical building, we go through the sections and various different criteria. Usually those two different criteria where you have low angle sun and the sun is on the upper overhead sun, we will check this. And you can see that it gives a color contour showing what is a light level is coming to the facade. Our aim is to bring the light much deeper to the floor plate. To do that, maybe we have to understand the glazing height. Sometimes you have to increase the glazing height or you have to get optimum size of the sunshades. And there's another approach we call as a thermal comfort. Okay, so we spoke about daylighting, and a thermal comfort is something building envelope is getting heated. And how do we make sure the heat is transferred inside so it put less pressure on air conditioning and there's no compromise on the user comforts. So that's all about thermal comfort. And thermal comfort basically approached in performance-based approach. There is a two different approach here where there's one approach you can directly go with the code-based approach as IGBC, sorry. Graha or whatever the codes, they say you follow 40-50% whatever the ratio, you have to use this material, that's one approach. And as we work on a lot of projects, it's a large scale project, a commercial project, this project is different as a special design, floor plates are different, building architecture is different. So it doesn't fit onto that book-based or prescriptive-based. So then we go for a performance-based where we can simulate the building and then we can see the real energy. Based on that, the decision has been taken. And primarily, it shows how much energy is impacting on which part of the facade and how do we deal with that particular elevation. And this one of the approaches, like this particular slide is showing, we could use various different glass types on different elevation of the facade, like lower performance glazing we can use on a colder side such as a north side, and a high performance glass we can use for a hotter side such as south and southwest side, where it will not have a major impact and it may have an economical solution. So there's a different glazing material can be all used on different elevation, though it may look strange, but it is practical. There are projects is done with the different elevation as a different glazing. Then we have to carefully see how is as an impact. And then in this approach, you can see the picture showing on the right. the solar heat flux is coming to whatever the showing on a red color, and the simulation has been done where it shows all the air conditioned space, how this internal space is getting cooled. And you can see as per the comfort level, we should get the neutral value. So it is not too much hot, especially if you have a perimeter facade facing direct heat, all the space which is about 2 to 3 meter space is getting too much heated, and that space become inefficient, then it may ended up just people use a blinds and that space will still get hotter. But to avoid this problem, where we do like a simulation based approach, so is a scientific approach, it is not just done in a thumb rule, where you can see the result what we usually get this kind of approach on the table on the left side. Single glazing, where we're trying to use as a base case as a medium performance, which means it's a economical solution. When we hover for a higher performance glass, is going to be an expensive solution. And option one, we can see as a base case. Option two is using tinted, a single double glazing on one side, which is a medium performance. And option three as another approach, where we all know use high performance glazing is better. So then there should be a decision, why should we need if we were high performance glazing in the next solution, where if I have a different approach, it gives maybe a similar performance at much lesser cost. If you can see option two versus option three, 5.36 versus 7.37%. So it's only marginal difference. And option two, you are getting a similar performance at much more economical cost. And we also to generally check on impact of the sunshade. So we all know sunshade is a great shading tool, but what is the size, where to put the sunshade so that it is really performing and is highly efficient. So we have to run various different options using either like what a table is showing, no sunshade, and then there's one smaller sunshade. And there's one 400 mm deeper sunshade, and then one 1200 mm extremely deeper sunshade. So the sunshades, the wider the sunshade is obviously better, but there are some construction difficulties here. Cost effective things is coming in, so we can't simply just do a very extended sunshade. It may work, but it has another impact of impractical solutions. So there will be an optimum solution where cost is not going very high, but you still have a very good performance. Like in this, it is showing a 400 mm deeper sunshade with a particular glass type will give a better performances. Same, we can see the impact of the energy efficiency on using without sunshade versus sunshade if you have a 1200 millimeter mm. As you can see in this table, it is showing like 8.6, about nearly about 9% energy efficiency, which is a good impact. So, which tells that the sunshade is really working here. And then we can move on to more on materials, construction methods. There are things which we can control through the design and not just theoretical design, and then little bit on the material side. And construction methods can also help to get the energy efficient facades. First, we have to understand the building envelope construction, how does it works. And as you can see in the picture on the right, left hand side, we have a traditional construction. Picture on the right side, you have advanced construction, where traditional construction has columns, beams, and we all the envelopes are filled with a brick wall or block wall. Wherever you have a windows, we need to put a windows. And advanced construction is this modern days, most of the commercial building predominantly use these techniques where we have just frames, column slabs, and then the perimeter facade is constructed with the various different materials, either cladding, glazing, or different material, but it uses a lightweight construction techniques. So this has an impact on overall energy efficiency as well. This slide is trying to show how the envelope construction works. We have the design, and then the design is getting fabricated. You can see most of the facade envelopes are prefabricated. The prefabrication done in the factory, and it goes as a panel system. And then you might have seen in a lot of commercial buildings, they are installing the panels floor by floor, and then it's getting enveloped. That is how it works. And whenever we are integrating this with the building, we have to make sure how is interfaced with the slab or beam. These panels come to the site and getting erected, and it has to then interface well with the building. And then we have to seal all the floors, so there are some interfacing and finishes comes in. In terms of energy efficiency, how energy efficiency help in this kind of a construction? As facades, from the architectural point of view, you may be seeing what is there in the visual area, and there are areas we call spandrel areas or opaque, which is above the ceiling and which is also part of the facade envelope. So we have to see as a holistic way, as an external skin, not just a glass, and how it is getting built so that we can get insulation much better than any traditional construction approach. In here, this slide showing there are a lot of material built up is getting constructed at the spandrel areas, where we can achieve much higher performances than the glass material, like an insulated wall. A lot of backpan aluminum metal sheet is there to hide those ceiling and interior spaces. And there are critical details as from the architect. Maybe it's good to know these interfaces, how it works. If you can see in this picture, the white band is showing a spandrel area, which is opaque area. How do we treat in front of the beams and columns? And this area is comes with the insulated cladding system, where the performance is much higher. We have layers built on that layer. What we can see from the glass, there's insulation material, there's aluminum add-up box, then there's something internal space which is treated. And in terms of numbers, performance of this built-up is important. It is something like similar to like a roof built-up. If somebody has experience on working on a roof, it's very similar. Other than the glass area, we have other areas like column beams done in a different way. And this slide shows different level of performances. As a U value is the easiest, the simplest way to measure the insulation or performance of the any wall built up. As you can see from the left, it is showing this built up is done with the 50 mm thick insulation and using high performance glass for the spandrel area. And the spandrel 8, the one at the middle, is showing 60 mm. And then we have a 75 mm insulation. The more insulation it adds up, we can see the insulation values is getting better. 0.447, the lower the number is better. And with the 70 mm insulation, we are achieving like a 0.34. This is much, much lower than, better than what IGBC and other course. They ask for a comply with the 0.44. If some of the clients want to go extremely much higher performance than code specified, they do this. Instead of 50 mm insulation, we can do 75 insulation. We can get much better performance. And it is not just a glazing area. There are other areas. If you see the whole building envelope approach, this built up is shown. Like if you have a brick wall of the airspace, and if you have insulated wall, we can get 0.47. And if you want to do the concrete wall and enhance this is got much better. And if you can see the brick wall as it is without any insulation or whatever, you are getting like a 1.92 U value. And if you have a concrete wall, and generally this part of the world, we don't insulate the wall and brick wall and a concrete, unlike like cold countries, they do insulate. So generally we don't insulate the brick wall or concrete wall. I just put this for comparison. And you can see concrete wall is has a 2.22 insulation. As some people may think, or as a perception, yeah, wall, concrete and brick wall is much better in terms of insulation. But we can see the brick wall has 1.92 U value, versus if you have a spandrel wall, it is 0.34. this is done with the amount of insulation, and also add the cost. So with high performance material and modern construction, there is no compromise. Rather, the performance are improved, of course, at the additional cost. And this table just to give an idea about different material, what is the U value, is the simplest scale to measure, right from brick wall to various built ups and combination, what is the values you can get it. And generally, IGBC or Graha recommend like 0.44 for the opaque or spandrel areas. And then we just touch base on a material. So not just a glass facade, it's not just a glass. So the architect or somebody can just see glass is a dominating material, but there are other areas we have to look at, such as like the natural materials. Excuse me. So when we look on a facade, it is not just a windows or a glass, what you can see through. There are areas which we have to take as a whole building envelope approach. Spaces, how do we treat the column spaces, beam spaces, core wall, service area? So that is how give the overall various spaces need a different material, different built up service area. Maybe we can just do with a simple brick wall or concrete wall. It doesn't have a major energy impact. So likewise, there should be a whole building envelope approach should be adapted. And there are some examples. There's various materials. It can go very well mixed with the glazing. It is not just a glass box building. And these days, there are also like Mumbai, there is a requirements for you have to use. You cannot use more than certain percentage of the glass on the building. So that there are certain high-rise buildings, they limit amount of glass using. So we have to mix use with the different material like metals, stones, like a terracotta. So various different materials are available. So it is not just a glass. And there's another way we can look at it, like a GRC material is quite lightweight material and ease of construction. There are building, lots of building has done before, which give a completely a different architecture, much more sustainable building, not necessarily an expensive building. And stone, in there are various stones available with a different color, different textures. Stone always go with any different facades. The picture on the right side, you can see the stones used nicely used on ground level up to two floor of the commercial building. All these spaces as a punched window, so it's a different approach. And this is another project. Granite stone has been extensively used with the lightweight constructions. Usually we see the stone facades done with a brick wall construction or heavier construction. There are buildings done with the stone used on a modern envelope approach, which means stone has set in as part of the envelope. So that's my last slide. Thank you for everyone. If any questions or anything we can.
Thank you. Thank you,
yeah,
Doctor.
Sure, thank you.
So that was quite interesting, and I think it would be more beneficial when the students get to ask some questions. I'll just open the floor for questions so the students can type in their questions, or they can message me so I can ask you as a presenter also.
Yeah.
So you can come here and ask your questions. So in the meantime, what is the current? I'll just use this opportunity to ask you a few questions of my own. So like students, whenever we talk about facades, they are very interested and talking about, like, the Singapore has that esplanade building, which we call as a cactus kind of facade. And then the Masdar, not Masdar, it's in the dynamic facade in
Mashrabi.
Yeah, Mashrabi, yes.
Yes,
how
yes.
and what kind of pre-planning or what kind of challenges these kind of facades pose to a consultant, and how do
There
you go
are
about
some,
it?
yeah, this in a way is like iconic buildings is done. I think once the idea is come in, then there is a challenge how do we implement this idea, and this idea is going to be real or can be implemented, how practical it is. I think then we don't have design challenges. It is more of how we make the idea to something constructible. So we work 50% architect, 50% as engineers. So we have to do rest of our engineering with the ideas given by these architects. So it's good to work on those challenges, but it is doable. These days, everything's doable. It is just is limited with the investment.
Yeah. So
Yeah.
one question has come up from Shivansh, and he's asking why is there less use of organic material in facade system? So students are quite intrigued, and I think we looking forward to algae, use of algae and other organic materials in the facade system. So I'll also share the link so he can be more vocal with the question.
Yeah, it's an interesting question where organic material, I think there are algae used on a facade. It is going on an experimental basis. Actually, there are a lot of materials can be used, but then it is just a limitation with longevity and then how much it can perform. There are like algae used on a facade done on an experimental basis. Unfortunately, these things sometimes it won't be successful on a lot of facade materials. This is taken on a commercial decision. And though there are buildings done in like a showcase building or something, an iconic building, leaving that, there are materials dominated is processed material. So unfortunately, that organic material is just some limitation.
So just a minute. So any more questions from the students? In the meantime, Shivansh is joining, so he can have an interaction with the So Ravi, you want to ask him some questions?
At the outset, I must really thank you for this lovely presentation that you did, and where you, especially where you, covered the aspect of directing daylight into the dimly illuminated interior regions of a building, and how it can be uniformly illuminated using daylight conditions, and with minimizing artificial lighting. I would want to make the students aware of what challenges does a designer face, as a facade designer face, when it comes to contractors' inability to do a perform or rather fulfill the design obligations, where the system itself, the technology is challenging, the contractor is not able to bring out the shop drawings or for the intended purpose. So where all have you faced such situations, and how have you how do you feel that the design has been compromised?
Okay, so you're asking me, Ravi?
Yes.
Okay, sure. I think your question about mostly concerned with the contractor's ability to do the designs and successful implementation. Okay. Yeah, I understand. I think from the facade aspect, unfortunately, the design is not given due respect. Okay. So Often the design is underestimated or taken as too simple. Like if you just put a piece of glass, it stand on the building, and there are things behind that. It is not appreciated. I think the problem with the facade industry, in my view, like 80% problems come from the design. If your design and details are resolved, there is less of problem at the site. Like if you have a stone facade and aluminium facade or various interfaces, how does it join? So if you are not resolving and sitting in the office, then there is impossible that they can do it correctly at the site. I think the problem with the contractor side, this is all driven by the commercial. There is not focus from the design, not necessarily from contractor. Even the client or investor who is building, he is not asking the right question at the right time. So he's not even asking the contractor, this detail is complex, how you're going to resolve it, show me how you're going to do it. So it is entirely solely relying on a contractor, but contractor trying their best. So there is a big design thing which is missing, which is, that's what we help those bridge the gap. So it is not a direct answer. I think it is still work in progress.
Yeah, in my past experience, I have generally found that the civil contractor, and his inaccuracy to make the walls in plumb or any structure in plumb, invariably the contractor who's the facade contractor who's doing a unitized glazing faces a lot of problems. So I'm just wanting to know as to how do we mitigate such problems and what are the kind of tolerances that unitized glazing can take in terms of inefficient and inaccurate civil construction?
Yeah, right. Good question, Pat. Even though surprisingly we use this for the construction, they use good formwork, aluminium shuttering, all this branded shuttering, we still have a big problem with the Indian construction tolerances. So there are buildings, we have even 30-story building, then even a straight box building, they are not able to maintain what is given in acceptable tolerances. Even though the acceptable tolerances is maybe 2 times, 3 times of the international tolerances, still they are not managing to achieve that. So there's a big compromise on a construction. Unfortunately, it is not properly supervised and managed on the civil contractor side. Those people sitting on the office, they only see the work progress. They only see what whether you put the steel rebars or there. But I rarely see somebody check what is a plumb line they have achieved until the facade contractor comes in. He's the one comes in, do the survey, then he comes with the report. So nobody does it. I think it is big supervision is missing on the tolerances level, which should be controlled before the contractor comes in. And then contractor can manage little reasonable tolerances. If your building supposed to have a slab in and out or a column plumb line, say 25 mm in a paper, they should achieve at least maybe 50 mm. So that is what the contractor, he does the design, he does the bracket fixing, he always take 2 times of the tolerances. But if the site is different, complete like a 3 times of the tolerances, then is a problem. Yeah.
Thank you.
So yes, we have Shivansh here. So Shivansh, you can ask your question.
There is some lag. Is my voice audible?
Yes.
Mom, there's mic echo coming through somewhere.
Have you joined from 2 devices, Shivansh?
No, just one.
Just one. Okay.
Okay. So yes, sir. So my.
Okay.
the Preetha is on right now. Preetha ma'am's mic is was on, so that. I guess Preetha ma'am's mic is on, that's why there's an echo coming through. Good afternoon, sir. So my question was basically, why is there less use of organic materials in facade systems? So we have seen in high rises, in different infrastructure projects which are coming up right now, we always see the extensive use of glass materials, glass for facade systems. So different ways in glass, glass is being used in different techniques, different methods. Some are small glazing, some is different spotted patterns, which you showed in the presentation as well. So why is there less use of less organic materials, such as bamboo is one which can be used for the organic facade system? Why is there some kind of disconnect over there? This was my question basically.
Actually, the organic material such as bamboo, timber is getting popular just 2-3 years. There are a lot of research is going on using a timber material. And if you just Google it, there are a lot of very high level research is going on timber building, timber used for constructions. I think these materials especially in Indian condition, we have a good material timber, hardwood. There are good timber can be used for structural applications. I think it's lacking with some engineering and some somebody has to push this to something usable. Unlike industry driven materials, their approach is different. Where to use this material, you have to work hard because there is no references available. You have to do a lot of homework to use this. So I think. We hope it will change. Even there are some recently development from National Building Code, IS Code. They are developing some standard for using timber as a material. So I think we will just have to wait a little more time so we can use these natural materials.
So one active use which we have seen, so ma'am was giving an example also at Singapore. I don't know, the hotel which has the whole facade is made up of plants. I'm just not
the park place. The park hotel.
Yeah, I guess the park on McPherson Street, I guess, and I'm forgetting the name of it. So Singapore is again using this system of gardening and facade system, both in combination. Mm-hmm. And I guess benefiting them a lot because of they have very small spaces over there, but you don't feel there's no suffocation of spaces over there. You don't get intimidated by that. So behind in my dissertation also I've done this. It's a color theory based on green.
Yeah, using a green wall is now adapted in lot of our Indian projects. The green wall is adapted, but the green walls adapted not on the entire building, is adapted on certain areas where it is easy to maintain. And I think if you even check in one of our website, we have a project called a Brigade Tech Garden in Bangalore. There's one facade has used extensive amount of green walls as just outside the glazing as office space. So it is used, carefully used, not everywhere and wherever that they feel is, because this need a lot of maintenance. That's how it is used, but it is getting noticed.
So this is basically on an experimental basis as of now. It has been started, but it's not prominent. I guess that's what you're saying.
It is just because if you have a building, we there are various different facade has a different treatment, different architecture, different. So it is getting noticed and it is used on certain project, but it will not be used on to replace something else, right? Because you still have other functions. You need light to come in and you need some ventilations to come in. So there are areas we're still using this green wall concept.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks, Shivansh. Also, I have seen lots of LED media being used in the facade system. So mm-hmm. is that getting prevalent, or what are the technical or considerations that we do for them?
Yeah, facade lighting. Basically, the facade lighting is getting popular because of this LED trend. Then it also consume very less amount of energy. There is no black points in terms of energy efficient point of view. The LEDs are much efficient. So it is now almost coming on every project. So previously it used to be just one in some projects. Now every project, as we have a challenge, how do we integrate this as part of the details so that it works? Otherwise, we somebody fix the lighting, it works for 1 year, after that it doesn't work. So it's a good visually appealing, and we make sure it works as a longevity.
Okay, yes. So lots of exploration, I think. Sorry, we lost you in between.
I just have one little thing to ask. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, Monisha.
Yeah. So we were just wondering, we do hear about a lot of, you know, harnessing the solar energy, and the people are now probably into even treating the facades where we can trap the solar, you know, solar energy. So maybe, you know, either glass panels which are embedded within those solar cells, or the solar energy panels which are can be used for our facades. And so is there a, can you just throw some light on that, if that aspect, so students will probably
yes, I think the energy harnessing through the facade is relying on a photovoltaic cell. Currently it is relying on the roof application. Unfortunately, it is not so much beneficial on the facades unless you have some horizontal space, where on a vertical application the efficiency is very low. And then it always shaded, building has the shaded, and then there is not enough area to get the energy from there. Now the predominant application, it happens on the roof application, and then sometime it happens with the sunshades, those horizontal ledges where they use photovoltaic. I think unless that completely a new technology comes in, the efficiency is very high on a vertical application. It doesn't need so much of light coming through. It may be then popular on a facade application.
So is it not much preferred to use, you're saying, till then?
Currently, it is not major beneficial using on a facade, because that output is very low, because it need to have like a 45 degree angle minimum exposure. And if you put a photovoltaic cell on the vertical face of the building, your energy harness will be extremely low.
Okay, so the percentage is low.
Yes, very low, very low. Then it doesn't give any benefit of return.
All right. Okay. So, but is there any anything in pipeline for that kind of a thing? Because we've been hearing about this. The people are
I think there are research. There are researches done. Last month somebody has made, because if you see the any photovoltaic cell, to my knowledge, at the maximum you have like 8%, 10% efficiency. So unless they bring something about 40-50% efficiency, then it may come through. So I think there are a lot of research is going on, which they call a thin film high performance PV cells. May come through maybe about years or 2 years time, I guess.
All right. Okay.
Yeah.
Probably wait, because a couple of our students are wanting to use that as an option when they're doing their project right now. So it's good for them
but they have to create on a horizontal, like I showed you in some of the slide, like sunshades.
Yeah.
You can create some ledges. Yeah.
And so in combination with the horizontal, you can add on to that. Is that still
better? Yes. But then again, you can use on a horizontal.
All right. Thank you. And there are certain glasses that you say which are photosensitive. Does that really help for looking in the long term? The expense of the glass and the manufacturing energy consumed for the glass. And if you balance it out with the energy that you save while if a glass Does it really, does the balance hold there?
Yeah, it works. It works as long as you justify energy harnessed is reasonable, then it will be justified.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And also, we are nowadays students exploring the parametric architecture and lots of facades. It's been basically used in facade development. So, yeah, how does it become challenging for a consultant, or is the architect always there to answer queries? How does this whole process of the design development by the architect and the execution by a consultant, and how does that work, and how do you manage parametric facades when it comes to that?
Yes. In fact, we are very passionate about using a 3Ds on our work, and you can see on our website that we put a lot of details. Parametric facades, we work quite intensively and we use for our projects, and we love to work on complex forms and different shapes. Luckily we have a lot of these tools available. There is used to be a design limitation. Now there is not much design limitation. Everything is doable. And it can also be constructable. Whatever design you are doing, make sure somebody has to construct that. It is getting noticeable, and there are some architects. Previously, they were limited with this. They have much better confidence now. And we are seeing a project on and off. There are 1 in 10 projects we do. We have these requirements. We are working.
Was there any anecdote or any challenge that you faced as a consulting
we love to do this. So it's, frankly speaking, there sometimes we don't get this opportunity. So as I said, it's only 1 in 10 job we get this. And so we want to give the confidence to the architect. So don't limit your imagination. You can design whatever you want. We have just to finish a building somewhere in Bangalore. It's actually egg building. So it is just an egg building. It's about 30 meter diameter building. It's in our website. You can see it, and it's been constructed.
Is it by James Law? Is it by James Law? Is the designer?
No. It is an architect, which is a local architect called. Which is part of a big project. They want to build this as a space for the meeting room, conference room for the large project. So that project we work quite intensely with advanced geometries. So the confidence level is getting better now.
And nowadays, with materials, newer materials coming into the market, and how challenging is to many times we see newer materials and the detail might not be available or might not be suitable as a facade, but many times architects explore options. Mm-hmm. Like ETFE has suddenly got praised into last 10-15 years and now quite extensively being used. So any such project in India or application, because that material we have seen in case studies and students have been exploring. But can you just throw some light on the material also?
ETFE, particularly ETFE, I think is getting popular because of the large applications done in the Singapore project. There are various projects especially done in Singapore as extensively used on ETFE material. Previously, it has some limitation of its fire performances. I think they have improved it. It is a good material, and it was like a fabric. Whenever you want to have open space, with a good daylighting, no compromise on aesthetics, that's a good material. It's a good material as long as you should know where you are using it, then it's appropriate material. And then other material getting wide applications, such as different finishes and different metallics and stones. A lot of new stones is getting used. And you might have seen a lot of our terracotta material, various texture, various, so those are all coming into this. Unfortunately, there are material limitation on a facade. Is unlike interiors, you can pretty much use anything you like. External, you may have a limitation on, even though that the supplier will say it's fantastic material, and we know certain materials has limitation, we can't use it. So there are some limitation, and it is the palettes are limited. But if you just mix and match with the various different material, then you will get a different facade.
Okay, so any more questions? Yes.
When you write specifications, Rajan, what kind of format do you use? Do you use a BU, or do you use CSI format, or what kind of format do you use when you write specifications?
I'm not sure about it. So we don't follow, especially the American style format.
Okay.
Which is those numbers. I don't know this comes to which format. We don't use it. I think we use a European style format.
Okay.
So it is not just a number where we write the specification and then the performance is clearly mentioned. You don't have to refer some other document.
Correct. Okay, fine. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, so I think that was very interesting.
Sure. Was it enough attendance? I could see it crossed about 70, is it?
Yeah, and most of some messages were there on the facing issues joining in, so they were logged in on the Facebook because I was in between coordinating with the IT person.
Okay,
so,
sure.
Yes. So thank you, Mr. Govind, for your time and such interesting thoughts on the facade system. It was really intriguing to have the industry perspective.
Yes. I would also like to take the opportunity to, if any of your students, I said to Ravi also the other day, keen to work on 3D geometries, parametric, we have opportunities here.
Okay.
So you can inform your students on advanced geometries. Sorry.
Thank you so much, Rajan. It will be an opportunity. They should consider this and grab the opportunity, in fact.
Yes.
Thank you so much for the offer.
Definitely, I'll be sharing it with the current as well as the pass out batch also. They can, definitely join in. Thank you, students.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, sir, you were saying something.
Your team and Ravi Chandran has put a great effort to organize this.
No, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your time. And thank you, everyone, for participating and benefiting from the lecture. Thank you, my fellow faculty colleagues. Thank you, Mr. Govind. And thank you, students.
Thank you.
We'll close the
thank
session
you.
Now. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.